I want to just start with the theme and the topic of this talk, which is the myth of climate change apathy. And really what we're looking at here right now is a moment in time. It's an incredible moment, actually, if you think about it. What's happening right now with regards to our confrontation and our ability to really apprehend what it means to be looking at engaging with these issues. I see this as an incredible opportunity right now. So what we're seeing is an incredible level of innovation. People are seeming to be waking up more. We're seeing signals that people are kind of starting to get it a bit more. There's a lot of innovation. There's a lot of technological, you know, advancements happening that are very exciting. And at the same time, I think one can see that there's also equally so an incredible sense of inertia and slowness and recalcitrance and what might seem to be retrograde. And I really see these things as happening concurrently. So one of the main things, one of the main questions that gets asked every time I speak is, you know, it's about people want to know what is the trajectory, is there hope? There's a lot of, you know, conversation right now about this topic of hope and despair. How do we keep going? How do we stay engaged? And what I'm seeing right now is really a profound confluence where we are seeing sort of the both and. We're really seeing unprecedented level of engagement, and we're also seeing an incredible sense of resistance. And what I'd like to do is to help, as best I can, offer some ideas to shed some light on what might be going on. And one of the things that's going on right now is a lot of people are thinking about what the psychology is of climate change. So this is really exciting for me in my field because it's been about 25 years that I've been looking at this intersection of what is and is there a psychology of environmental issues and climate change. Now we're seeing an incredible kind of abundance of research and books coming out, whether it's George Marshall's book, Per Stoeckness' book. There's new reports coming out. The APA now has a task force on climate change. There's a lot going on. And what I'd like us to do tonight is to begin to perhaps get a bit of clarity around what is going on, to make sense of this landscape, because in fact, not all psychology is equal, and not all psychology is the same. And so really my intention of this evening and this talk is to really sort of bring some clarity so that you all and we all can begin to engage with this material from a place of more insight and understanding and skill. So the first thing that I'm going to look at are some of the myths that are circulating right now. And I would call them myths. And you can see if any of these resonate with you. So the first is, how do we get people to care more? How many of you have had this thought at some point in your work or in your personal life? How do we get people to care more? Okay. What will it take to motivate people to act? So I spend quite a bit of time working with organizations. It does not matter whether it's governmental, private, public, educational. Really, the question on everyone's mind is, how do we motivate people to act? So this whole way of thinking about motivation is really central right now. Climate change is too abstract, difficult for people to get their heads around. Have you heard this before? You know, there's quite a bit of research looking at how we process information, and that, in fact, is just too damn hard for people to really get their minds around, and that we are designed and we're wired to respond to crisis in the short term, and the immediate and the tangible. And our brains are just not wired to cope. So there's quite a lot going on right now around, you know, it's just too much. There's an expression called time-space distanciation that Anthony Giddens came up with, a sociologist, which means that with climate, you know, we don't see the effects for very long, and it's time-space distanced. And so it's very hard for our human minds to come to terms with. And I actually invite us to really reframe these questions. Because, in fact, these questions and these assertions are based on a lot of assumptions that we often don't take the time to really think about. And we don't think about them because, frankly, we're under a lot of pressure to act and to mobilize and to respond. There's an incredible sense of urgency right now, and we don't really take the time to think about how our understandings and assumptions of human nature and what it means to be a human being are informing our assumptions about, you know, why and how we're responding to these issues. And so what I'm interested in doing is actually reframing these questions. How can we awaken our innate capacities for deep care and unlimited creativity? Now, some of you might be thinking, yeah, right, you know, you're not really quite there with me. And you might be feeling like, well, wait a minute, people really don't care. And we actually really do need to motivate people. And what I want to invite us to think about is what kinds of assumptions that is based on is a premise that if people, if what we care about is, you know, there, then we will necessarily act. And that is actually kind of an interesting assumption, because how often is it that we actually don't act on what we care about? Do you see what I'm saying? That in fact, human beings are quite irrational and contradictory, and we have a lot of conflict and tensions that we're negotiating all the time. So this assumption that what we care about will necessarily translate magically into our actions is in fact a bit of a fantasy. Now, I'm not saying that we don't care, you know, it's not cut and dry. Of course, what we act on tends to reflect some investments that we have and attachments that we have and values that we have. But what I'm wanting us to do is to really shake up this notion that we act on our values and what we care about in some sort of kind of unified, simplistic way. Are you with me? So the idea here is that, in fact, within any given person, we can have multiple cares. We can have multiple values, and they are often in conflict with one another. So this idea of how do we awaken our innate capacities for deep care and unlimited creativity comes out of many, many decades of research in psychodynamic, psychoanalytic, attachment theory, trauma studies that really understands that, in fact, our brains are wired for compassion. We do have an innate need to feel, you know, creative and to have deep care. But what happens with the climate threat is that it tends to short-circuit our capacities to access these experiences and these feelings. And that's what I want to look at a bit more in depth with you. So what we're talking about here is the art and science of awakening reparation. And I use the term reparation deliberately. Reparation is a term that comes primarily out of psychoanalytic psychology. And there's a whole science and study of what it means for humans to want to make repair, right? And that's really kind of the moment we're in right now, isn't it? That we need to be activating and mobilizing our desire and capacity to make repair. When you see damage that's been done, how we respond to that with an instinct and an impulse to repair, to fix, to heal, to restore, to create. And my guess is that a lot of people in this room are perhaps quite in touch with that capacity and are wondering why more people are not in touch with that capacity. You know, how can people see and be aware of what's happening and not just automatically want to become activated? Right? So that's really the puzzle. That's the challenge that we're in right now, that we're looking at, is really the reframe from that there's a lack of care, there's a lack of concern, there's a lack of motivation, and in fact, that we have incredible capacities for all of these things. Now, I included this slide with some ambivalence on my part, but it's important to acknowledge that for whatever we might think about, you know, Freud and Freudian psychology and psychoanalysis, it's actually come a long way since Freud was generating his ideas, but so much remains true and the same and active in the practice of psychology. And so I want to kind of, you know, recognize and pay homage to the insights that we have available to us through psychoanalytic psychology. And so, you know, one of the primary insights that I have found to be so powerful from psychoanalytic psychology is precisely an understanding of unconscious processes, that we are not always driven by our rational selves, that we have unconscious kind of dimensions going on. And the concept of conflict, and that when anxiety is aroused for us, and arguably, I would say, climate change threats and environmental degradation arouse anxieties, then we will see mechanisms that kick in to help us manage those anxieties. Now, psychoanalytic psychology is really good at understanding that. I mean, really good. So, you know, when I first started reading Freudian work and psychoanalytic work about 20 or 25 years ago, it was honestly hard for me to pick up any of those texts and not immediately relate it to what's going on in our environment, in our environmental movement, and how we're relating with the environment, which seems really perhaps kind of out there. But it's kind of amazing because what's being described with quite nuance and insight really describes what we're seeing happening out there in terms of, you know, what we're looking at that manifests as apathy, that manifests as a denial, that manifests as polarization. All of these things that we talk about and we describe are actually phenomena that are quite well understood in the psychodynamic and psychoanalytic world. And so I'm really interested in looking at how we can begin to take some of this and figure out how to apply it as best we can in these very different contexts. So, you know, what we're looking at here are insights from psychoanalytic psychology, but also incredible insights that have been generated through neuroscience and attachment theory and trauma studies. And, you know, really, we're at this moment right now where our level of insight into the human mind and what it means to be a human being is really exploding. It's exploding right now. I mean, there's a conference taking place online starting tomorrow on Friday called Psychotherapy 2.0. It's through Sounds True, and it's basically looking at all the innovation that's happening. The psychological world is going through an explosion right now. It really is. People are having to rethink and reframe our assumptions about what it means to be a human with insight with attachment theory and neuroscience. And we have that for those of us working in the climate movement, in communications and messaging and engagement. We have access to that if we want to be having access to that. In other words, it's a resource that we can begin to be looking at. So I want to just do sort of a level set right now. So we've been talking about, you know, there's all this insight going on, and it's really sort of an explosion in the field of the psychology of climate change and the psychology of environmental issues. And for a project that I was working on for Skoll Global Threats Fund, I was producing a report that was intended to be sort of a landscape report of what does the social science say right now that, you know, about the psychology of climate change. And as I started to get into this project, I realized that there were these sort of distinct ways that we have of looking at these issues. So I want to run through these briefly with you, because I have a feeling that some of them might be already familiar and might be areas that you feel drawn to and are attracted to just level set so we see kind of the landscape we're in, okay? So the first is the behavior change. part of the quadrant. So the behavior change is really asking this question, how do we get people to do what we want them to do? And this is really, really exemplified by books like Nudge and Shift. And, you know, basically when you see words like push and pull and switch and drive and levers and motivators and so forth, that we're in this domain of the behavioral economic. And that behavioral economics has its own history, its own legacy, okay? And so for some people, this is the psychology of climate and environmental issues, is to look at behavior change. Does this resonate with some of you? Are you, you know, familiar with this kind of obsession with behavior change? And there's a tool there. So it's kind of like the mentality is, how do we kind of get people en masse to do what we need to do quickly, as expediently as possible? The next kind of area that we're seeing emerging is an interest in framing and messaging. And for some of you, I'm guessing this is really a really key issue. How do we frame and message? And this relates to research like George Marshall's recent book that really focuses on messaging and framing. Lakoff, you know, the idea of using metaphors. Values-based work. Catherine Hayhoe, who comes from an evangelical background, we need to message in light of our faith and our values. It's really primarily interested in how do we shift? How do we mobilize using the power of framing? Third is really the kind of social innovation. How do we design a better world? Okay, so this is really kind of demonstrated by the concept of social innovation, the challenge, so the resilience challenge, and the idea of having challenges to accelerate innovation really is in this kind of technological system, so that really this is what's needed. This is what's going to save us, is to have this kind of focus on the technological, infrastructural innovation. And then there's the emotional experiential domain. And there's a rising number of people, myself included, who are really interested in, well, wait a minute, you know, these issues are really scary. And they're bringing up a lot of distress for people. And what does it really mean to have to come to terms with these issues? What does it mean for us in our lives, in our communities, as members of a particular nation, as a state? What does this mean? How is this processed at the experiential and the emotional level? And this orientation tends to really kind of have an interest in conversation. So, you know, some of you might have been hearing more about this concept of like climate conversations, climate cafes, carbon conversations. So the idea is that amazing things happen when people are able to talk with one another. That it's kind of like magic, really. It's the most simple kind of behavioral change tool we may have, is simply when we create context for people to talk with one another. And, you know, one of the inspirations in this area really, for me, comes from Rosemary Randall's work. She's a British psychotherapist who founded an organization in the UK called Cambridge Carbon Footprint, which then gave rise to a project called Carbon Conversations. And it's now being rolled out across the UK, and it's now, there's folks in North America. It's really simple. People get in small groups and talk about how do we reduce our carbon footprint. And so the idea here is that really it's about having people create these contexts to support one another. So the area that I'm most interested in highlighting here for us is, of course, the emotional and the experiential. And I really want to impress upon you that I believe that this is critical for our efficacy and our abilities to be successful in the work that we're doing. And it can be whether you're working in an organization or you're working on these issues in your own personal life and you're trying to understand how to better communicate with people and your coworkers or families and friends. But really, it's understanding how humans manage distressing information, how we manage things that make us anxious is our gold. It is our gold. And the more that we skip over this and we try to sort of sidestep it, the harder our efforts are going to be, that we're going to continue to meet with what's called resistance. You know, if there's any psychotherapist in this room, you know what I'm talking about when I say resistance, because it's one of those terms that psychotherapists use a lot, because we as humans have resistance to change. So people come in, and of course we're not talking about a therapeutic set situation. People pay to come in and work with someone and have a lot of resistance to looking at what's actually going on, right? And that's the work of the psychotherapeutic interaction, is working with resistance. So if we think about our work in this area as really involving human resistance, this is intended to be empowering for us, okay? This is not about feeling overwhelmed that I have to suddenly become a psychotherapeutically attuned person. It's actually not about that. But it is about framing our work and bringing into the center of our work in climate and the environment that these are distressing and really profound issues that we're dealing with, that everyone is going to be dealing with them in their own particular ways, and that it really behooves us to become as skilled as possible. Now, what happens is that we tend to have this pattern of sort of ricocheting, and I say we, those who are working in areas of messaging and engagement and trying to work with people around this, that we feel like we either have to become cheerleaders to avoid bringing up distress and to say, actually, look how exciting this is. Do you know how amazing Seattle can be? Seattle can be a ecotopia. You know, this is all really good for us. This is good. You should be behind this. This is really juicy and this is really sexy stuff. And we're going to give you some incentives and we're going to make it fun and we're going to create a game and we're going to, you know, gamify it. You don't have to really think a whole lot about it. And isn't this exciting? People want positivity and they want good stories and they want success. Positive, positive, positive. This is sort of a pitfall that we tend to fall into. So we ricochet between that and the, you know, wake up. Like, don't you understand that we are messing up and we are very bad? Humans are so bad. Look at what we've done. We've completely made an incredible mess of everything. And if you're not doing something about this right now, you either, you know, are greedy, selfish, stupid, short-sighted, all of those. And so we do this kind of ricocheting. It's a little bit manic, or it's a little bit sort of splitting, in that we tend to kind of feel like we have to be either rah-rah or we have to really hit people over the head. And in fact, what if there's a way to integrate these so that it's not one or the other? And that is exactly what I'm interested in and what I want to talk about, because I know it's possible. I know it's possible. So I came up with something called the three A's, and some of you have heard me talk about this quite a bit, so I'm going to say it again. So I transitioned from being a full-time academic to being mostly a practitioner about 4 years ago. And I was going out and talking to people about all the psychoanalytic stuff and talking about, you know, denial and disavowal, and it was like not working. It was not working. And so I ended up, you know, sort of being forced to come up with a tool or a way to really kind of encapsulate what it is that we're looking at here. And I came up with the three A's. And I'm very proud of having three A's. So the first A is anxiety. So first is anxiety. There is anxiety always, I believe, in the context of sustainability and climate change. I believe that it might be a different kind of anxiety. It might, you know, vary. But there's going to be some element of anxiety. Okay? There's ambivalence. And ambivalence is actually one of the most important concepts that we can use in this work. Ambivalence means it's a clinical term. It doesn't mean I don't care. Ambivalence means you are literally pulled in different directions. You're literally have coexisting desires. So I do not want to be contributing to environmental degradation, and I did fly here. I did participate in a practice that I know is contributing to the problem. That's ambivalence, right? That we want different things. And ambivalence is incredibly important in relation to climate change because we're being asked to call into question a lot of practices that we as humans have designed and developed to be human. What makes us who we are, what our identities are invested in. So that could be for you going on a certain kind of trip or traveling or, you know, eating certain things or participating in certain activities that you're now being told are part of destroying the planet. That's really heavy. It's really heavy. And so when we're talking to people about climate, we're basically saying, sometimes I have a cartoon of the Gary Larson where the guy's talking to the dog, and all the dog hears is blah, 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 and the name, Ginger, blah. And I feel like with climate, a lot of the time, all people are hearing when we talk about it is negation of who you are and how we are to live. And then we wonder why people aren't engaging more in figuring out a solution. So ambivalence is really important. And third is aspiration. And we need to stay connected with this too. So going back to the earlier slide around our innate capacity. So this comes from, for me, it's inspired by the work of Winnicott, a psychoanalyst who made incredible breakthroughs on understanding children and play. Winnicott studied for many years people and young people and really recognized that we as humans do have a need to be creative. We do have a need to contribute. We have a need to be part of something. We have a need to belong, to be part of a group, right? And so this is the aspirational piece. And a lot of times it goes back to the cheerleading where we feel like we have to sort of only go there. But the point that I want to make here is that when we leave out one of these A's, we are not speaking to the whole picture. Is this making sense? So we have to be able to acknowledge and integrate all three, okay? So what does this look like? What does this look like in practice? Now, to be honest, I feel like what it looks like in practice is all of our work, okay? So it's all of us to innovate and design what it looks like in practice. So I can't tell you, here's the formula, what it looks like. But in fact, it's actually, I don't think that complicated. You know, I think it can be very simple. So for example, it's about listening, okay? So listening to people and understanding where the, you know, anxieties might be, where the ambivalence might be. Now, there's a lot to be said about this, and I'm happy to talk with any of you later. You can get in touch with me later, but this is a big part of what I do as a researcher because it's about listening. And it's not just about talking with people, it's how we talk to people and how we listen. So it's really paying attention to what is your experience? What is coming up for you right now? What are you concerned about? What would support you? And it's less about, would you support this carbon tax? How do you feel about, you know, this particular issue? Because when we ask direct questions, we tend to get that defensive kind of reflex, right? But it's about finding our way in through the side and really listening, which means we have to be curious, which is a whole other story, because some of us may not feel very curious. We might be too upset to be curious. And that's okay. It's okay to be too upset to be curious, just to be aware that that's what's happening. There's the acknowledgement. So know my anxieties, my ambivalence, and my aspirations. So if we're looking at how to apply this, imagine a messaging campaign that spoke to these three A's. You know, what that might look like. So perhaps a campaign that basically comes out and says, isn't this scary? Isn't this overwhelming? If you're like me, you don't want to have to think about climate change. It's a flipping drag, you know? And you probably want to be contributing and doing the right thing, and you probably still want to buy the things you love to buy and go on the trips you love, and, you know, that makes total sense. That makes total sense. And we're actually organizing this campaign, this project. It would be awesome if you were part of it. So, you know, I'm just kind of making this up off the top of my head, but it's basically touching on these three. Now, why are we touching on these three? Because what we're doing is we're looking at how we navigate defenses and defense mechanisms, right? So when anxieties are aroused, we tend to go into, you know, involuntarily, we protect ourselves. So we want to deny, we want to avoid, we want to numb out, we want to distance. What we're looking at here and what we're doing are strategies for disarming our defenses, right? So, you know, again, psychotherapists, sort of this is what they do. They do this because they're trying to support behavior change in people. And I don't see any reason why we can't be doing the same thing in our climate work. And the third is about engagement. And this is really quite a big topic in this work right now. There's a lot of talk about engagement and what does it mean to engage. Engagement often means, for a lot of people, getting people to do what we want them to do. But we are smart. We can sense when we're being manipulated. We can sense when we're being sort of spoken to in a way where we don't have a lot of agency and a lot of creativity and a lot of power. Does this make sense? So what I'm really interested in is engagement that's genuinely engaging. What do you think? What are your ideas? What would make sense for you, right? So creating context for people to exercise more of their own sense of creative engagement. Because believe me, people want to be asked. And we're often not asked, you know, in our workplaces and schools. And, you know, we're not asked. So again, this is an opportunity for us to tap into some energy that's there to be leveraged. Right? So again, going back to this idea of reframing from feeling like we have to get and push and pull people to how do we work with people who might appear to be completely disengaged? What does it look like if we work with people in a way that actually might create some opening, some invitation? Now, the phrase here, guide me, don't write me, comes out of motivational interviewing. And for some of you might be familiar with motivational interviewing, but it's a strategy and a whole field that's developed out of public health that is actually very powerful. And the idea of guide me, don't write me is a term terminology that's referred to our tendency to want to write people. So for example, you know, if we're talking to someone about smoking or, you know, sugar consumption, this is where how motivational interviewing came out of. You know, we have a tendency to say, well, you should want to do this. This is the right thing. Here's all the reasons why. The guiding is a way to bring people out so that people can actually own their own process. Okay? So it's really about listening, and it's about asking questions. And, you know, it's like, well, would you consider this, or have you thought about that? And, you know, it's kind of taking that more empathy, compassion, listening-led approach. So engagement is really about recognizing my needs to exercise my creativity, impact, and efficacy. And the piece around not patronizing, feeling like we have to sort of dumb down, I feel quite strongly about. Because I think that in our urgency to want to mobilize and incite action, we inadvertently have a tendency to communicate with people in a way that is potentially patronizing. And so what I'm interested in is, you know, what does our work look like if we actually, you know, take some of this on board and are cognizant of the fact that most people are actually really scared and feeling really overwhelmed about what's going on. And when those fears are not acknowledged, we tend to sort of fill in the gaps with our own worst fantasies, right? And so, you know, really what we're talking about is a compassion-led approach. That's one way I think about this work, which is sort of the irony of speaking on the same night as Brené Brown. You know, because I really feel like we're not talking about separate things here, but the context might be a bit different in what we're looking at, which is how to channel this work and our understandings of compassion. And what I really love about this quote of the Dalai Lama is that it reflects my feeling that I'm wanting to convey, which is that I don't feel that this is a luxury. I feel that, in fact, our abilities to be effective in creating the kinds of changes that we need to see happening at the scale we need to see happening does require compassion. It requires our abilities to feel with not only others, but with ourselves, and to really recognize that, you know, this is a messy situation, and we didn't intend this to happen. We didn't intend. You know, no one set out to create the level of damage and destruction that we're seeing happening, right? And that's, to me, the poignancy. That's what's truly heartbreaking to me about the situation, is that we thought we were doing what was right and what was good in our, you know, industrialization. Earlier today, we saw a little bit of an excerpt from a performance by a composer, Christoph, do you remember his? So, well-known composer here in Seattle, Christoph. And he's going to be showing this performance at the Impact Hub on the 30th, and I strongly encourage everyone to go. So he was presenting a performance of imagery. He was commissioned to create a composition about climate change. And so he designed this composition, then he brought in, well, I'm going to include some imagery here to help us kind of engage with this piece of music. And then he brought in spoken word and had a young woman write a poem, an amazing poem, to go with the words and the sound and the images. And what was really compelling and so moving about the excerpts he shared is, man, like, we have really messed up, but we didn't mean to. And that, for me, was so heartbreaking, is that, you know, industrial achievements were considered and still are achievements, right? But we've really obviously gone astray, and that, you know, as far as what, you know, underlies that level of disconnect that's enabled us to do what we've been doing is, I think, invites our compassion. I really do. So I included this. This is the first time I've done this, but I included Kuan Yin and the goddess of the Buddhist goddess of compassion, because I think that this can be really helpful for us to think about how this can inform and influence our work. But what I want to also say is that this is Padmasambhava, which is another deity representing compassion that's fierce. It's fierce. And so what I want to leave us with is this sense that being compassionate, understanding the psychological mechanisms that underlie our apathy and our lack of engagement, does not mean that we need to be soft and kind of namby-pamby and weak and without fierceness and without the warrior that we need to be channeling. In fact, we can be compassionate warriors, and we need to be compassionate warriors, because what are warriors without compassion, right? I mean, where are we, and what are we doing when we're engaging in that? And so I want to encourage us to think about, as we develop our capacities to navigate these human dimensions, to think about it as your swords. You know, Dan Siegel, the neuroscientist, wrote this book, Mindsight, wonderful book, and he says, awareness is the scalpel. Awareness is the scalpel that cuts through that enables us to make changes that we need to be making in our lives. And so that's really where I'm at with this, and why I'm here speaking, and why I'm committed to doing this work, is because, you know, I'm really interested to see what this movement looks like, what our work looks like if we really take this on board. And I don't know exactly what it looks like, but I think that we all can figure that out and apply our own ingenuity and insight and creativity and passion and warrior and fierceness. So I'm going to end on that note and open things up for discussion. So thank you.
I had a question about the, being an economist, incentives are good. Mm-hmm. You know, so mm-hmm. You're talking about don't incentivize me. And I was thinking, well, to me that sounds like you're saying don't bribe me.
Mm-hmm.
Rather than, you know, as an economist, you sound kind of want to incentivize the things that you don't necessarily do automatically, the private sector doesn't do well, like take care of public health well.
Right.
Or in this case, take care of the environment well.
Right. Right. So to respond to that point around incentives, mm-hmm. So incentives are really kind of have been quite big in the sustainability sector, right?
Oh,
and so the idea is that when we focus on incentives, we're sending a message, which is that this is an activity or a practice that you wouldn't ordinarily want to be doing unless we sweetened it up for you. And actually, there's a book by Dan Pink, some of you may know, called Drive. You may know Dan Pink's work, where he talks about intrinsic motivation versus extrinsic motivation. There's a wonderful RSA animation that distills this beautifully, where there's an abundance of research that shows that incentives, after a certain point, do not work. They actually backfire. They actually backfire because they're conveying that this is not something you would normally want to do, and we have a radar for being bribed, right? And so the idea is that if we can tap into those intrinsic motivations, which he identifies as purpose, mastery, and autonomy, which is very similar to what the psychoanalysts have been saying, you know, that we have these we need to have purpose, to experience mastery, and to experience autonomy. So that's where I'm coming from with the incentive. I think we all know some incentive can be valuable, right? Like, you know, you're retrofitting your house and you get a little bit of a rebate on replacing something. That's cool. But it's being mindful of how much emphasis we place on the incentive and not looking to the incentive to do the heavy lifting for us. I think that that's where the reframe can happen.
Thanks so much for being here. This was a fantastic talk.
Thanks.
I would love to hear you talk a little more about apathy, which was in the title of the lecture, and that wasn't one of the three A's. So I'm curious on your thoughts of, does that mean that apathy doesn't exist? It's just anxiety or ambivalence? Mm-hmm. Or is it ambivalence, like, is what we perceive as apathy, but it's really just people being pulled in different directions?
Right.
Yeah, how are you defining apathy?
Yeah, that's a really good question. Here's my theory about apathy. My PhD was actually called The Myth of Apathy, and the book I'm working on is called The Myth of Apathy. And the reason why is because I see apathy as a defense mechanism. And so what happens is that we tend to fixate on the apathy as if it is a kind of a thing, like a phenomenon, like, oh, you know, the public the public is apathetic and so forth. And so in doing so, we sort of reify, it's like reifying a symptom, rather than looking at what's actually going on under the surface. So apathy is a very well-known defense mechanism. I didn't make that up. It's been well-documented as one of the kind of main strategies that humans engage in to cope. And the reason I think it's very important to pierce and shatter the myth of apathy is because it blinds us to looking at what's actually going on, which is, I would say, pain. You know, I think it's very painful to be out of alignment. It's very painful to be problem-solving beings, which we are. We're wired to solve problems. We're being presented with a situation that appears to be potentially not solvable. And so that's intolerable. And so what do? We withdraw, we check out. And so the research I did actually for my PhD was interviewing people in Green Bay, Wisconsin, who appeared to be apathetic about what was going on in the environment, because I used a survey. And again, you know, there's a lot of issues with surveys, but I was, you know, experimenting with how people show up in a survey and what happens when you actually sit and talk with them. And what I found in these interviews, these conversations, is that they were anything but apathetic. They were actually in a lot of pain. But the situation was that they just, there was a sort of a resignation. Like, oh, well, you know, it's already, the lakes, the Great Lakes are already messed up. And, you know, there was this like, but not at a conscious level. And so the theory that I'm working with the myth of apathy, and what the book is about, is that when people are experiencing that kind of pain and loss, and it's not actually acknowledged, it sort of goes into this like underground place. And so all the efforts of all the environmental organizations to say, hey, look at what we're doing to protect and restore the Great Lakes, and it just sort of doesn't penetrate. Does that make sense? So the three A's are what I recognize as being present in our dilemmas and confrontation with environmental issues. So there's, you know, so apathy is a expression or symptom of what happens when there's such acute anxiety that comes up, right? So, yeah, I hope that helps. Yeah.
I know for me personally, sometimes it feels like I'm not doing my part for climate change so much as just trying to assuage my guilt about it.
Right.
And it's not a motivating feeling, but it's right. Always there.
Right, exactly. So, and I'd be really interested to know what other people in the room feel about guilt, because I have a feeling there's some perspectives on this topic. My view is that guilt is, it's a negative affect. And affect, A-F-F-E-C-T. So it's and I'd be interested in what you think, Kate. but it's a negative affect in that it's not an experience that I think is productive or constructive to evoke and to base our actions on. I think if Brené Brown was in the room, she would have a lot to say about guilt. I think that there's a difference between having a sense of a moral kind of imperative and a moral conscience, and that pang that happens when you know that you're doing something that's transgressive, and guilt. Guilt is when it becomes, you know, internalized, and it starts to just sort of take up a lot of energy. And so I think the best thing we could do would be to work on healing and assuaging guilt as best we can. It's like, I'm not saying let's all kind of get off the hook. I really need to be clear about that. But also from my point of view, guilt is not a helpful experience and motivator.
Thank you.
So, I'd welcome other thoughts on that if we can. So,
my question is about educating the younger generations about mm-hmm. climate change. And as you mentioned, I think as adults, we are so mired in this anxiety and ambivalence and trying to pull that apart and figure that out, that maybe we don't have the proper resources to guide or model
mm-hmm.
Children mm-hmm. how to deal with these emotions.
Mm-hmm.
And perhaps maybe they aren't even aware that they're feeling anxiety or ambivalence yet.
Mm-hmm.
But I think they have, to their advantage, more aspiration, perhaps, mm-hmm. than we do mm-hmm. as adults. So how do you recommend, or how do you personally overcome that and strive to teach children about climate
mm-hmm.
change?
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, one project that I've been working on recently is with high school students. And that's been really amazing. So there's an organization called the Alliance for Climate Education, ACE. And ACE does assemblies with high school students around the country. And they're starting a new campaign that's called Provisionally Have the Talk, that they want to mobilize young people to have the talk with their parents about climate. And yeah. And their fantasy is that this is going to actually create a sea change. And so they're designing this campaign. It's actually going to happen. And what I did is I designed what I called these learning labs for high school students around the country. And they were sort of like a focus group, but also a training in how to have conversations, because I am really scared of the idea of young people having these conversations with their parents and then just being completely annihilated with their parents' anxiety and vitriol, right? And so I feel like we need to really prepare people to how to have these conversations. So what I experience is you're right. I mean, there's a huge amount of there's a high level aspiration. You know, there's a lot of energy that's really aspirational and really positive. But I also experienced that these young people were deeply appreciative of the opportunity to recognize that other people and themselves are also having these other kind of more difficult feelings. And they felt that it was very empowering to come at it from this kind of orientation, because it took less pressure off them to feel like they had to go and persuade people. That was one thing I could have had up here, is like a line through the idea of we have to persuade. So I guess I'm not, you know, I mean, that I feel like the best thing that we could be doing right now is to be working with anyone who works with young people, like teachers and educators and community leaders, to what I would call break the taboo against talking and acknowledging how hard these things are. And just make it natural, make it normal. It doesn't have to be a big, heavy thing, but just like, yeah, this is, this is messed up. and you know, allowing just that space for people, but not that we have to stay there very long. That's the thing, is like we're so resilient as humans that all we need is just a touch of the truth. Like, yeah, this is messed up. And we can move on pretty quickly to the solutions. But unless we have that kind of, yeah, this is messed up, it's hard, I feel with you, we kind of, you know, so many people have written eloquently about this. Like, we need to feel like we're heard. Our feelings are going to keep coming up until they're heard, you know. And anyway, so I don't know if that totally responds to your question. I think it's really important that we do model for young people how to relate with these issues.
I really appreciate that question, too, as a long-term educator myself, who's stepping out of the classroom because of my passion and interest in sustainability and climate change education. And these exact issues, I'm noticing, not only make it difficult for students to open and absorb the information being taught, but teachers' willingness to teach it. And so the exact same issues we've got with students are happening with teachers as well. Mm-hmm. And I'm partly here to learn how to work with that, and I'll be there Friday as well.
Oh, great.
Look forward to it. I'm really excited about the ACE program you're talking about, or your work with them.
Yeah.
But separate from that, my question has to do with kind of the what you had in your quadrants, the upper right.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not sure if you're familiar. It sure looked very similar to Ken Wilber's mm-hmm. four quadrants, integral mm-hmm. theory. And then the lines of development, mm-hmm. particularly in the contributions of developmental psychology and levels of consciousness and all. And I'm wondering what you think about the promise of really taking those into consideration when working with messaging and educating. Either adults or students.
Well, I'm not as tuned in to the work you're referring to, the developmental. I mean, the quadrant was inspired by integral theory.
Okay.
There's no question about it. Mm-hmm. So there's someone named Barrett Brown who has applied integral theory to sustainability.
That's excellent.
And so it's really powerful work. And it just so happened that while I was pulling this work together, the report, someone just kind of showed me the quadrant, the integral, And I was like, well, wait a minute, that's a reflection, a mirror of the thinking out there. Mm-hmm. Isn't that interesting? Yep. That we have kind of been acting that out at that level. Yeah. So it suggests there's something kind of fundamental or almost archetypal going on. And so what I didn't probably emphasize enough in the quadrant is that we need all of those quadrants. So it's not just that the emotional and the experiential is like king. In fact, I went into the work thinking and feeling that it is, because I can be kind of evangelical about that. And I was like, until, you know, it's really the psychosocial and the, you know, and I realized, oh my God, like, we need them all. And that any one of those without the others is partial and limited and kind of stunted. And so that's the point that I really did want to make. Mm-hmm. But I think having at least a map can help us at least navigate. So my fantasy is that if you read an article, you see a paper, or you read a book, and you're like, oh yeah, this is kind of coming from that more behavior change orientation. And so it's not to diss that. It's just so we can kind of locate that and say, oh, well, how might, you know, social marketing, right, which I just, you know, someone might have just done a training in or something, right? Mm-hmm. How does that relate to this work I'm reading about on social innovation? So that's what I'm interested in, seeing how we can bring these in new and different combinations, mm-hmm. depending on the context and the challenge that we're facing. Because sometimes it might require more of a nudging situation, and sometimes it might require more of a let's have a conversation kind of cafe. Yeah. So, but I'm less tuned into. I'm not as like grounded in those traditions that you mentioned. Okay. So.
And have you know of the work of Karen O'Brien?
I don't.
She's also an integrally informed person mm-hmm. working in Norway with. Integral approach to climate change.
Okay.
And the transformative part. So
right.
I'll share more on Friday.
Okay. So integral theory, for those who may not be aware, is it's a body of work that was produced by Ken Wilber, and it's a way of kind of mapping the human consciousness, and so there's people that have gone out and been sort of applying integral theory in lots of different ways and developing consultancies around that. So just some context there. So, hi.
Thank you so much for bringing, I'm too short for this, for bringing this subject here, especially mm-hmm. from a behavioral perspective. There were two things. One thing that came to mind while you were speaking was the idea of cornucopianism. And so, you know, there's like, I think of it as we have this majority under the bell curve that, like you said, does care, but is overwhelmed and mm-hmm. doesn't really know, you know, how to translate that into their daily behaviors. But then there are these people on the, you know, extreme ends of the curve who believe that there is no such thing as scarcity, and we kind of don't need to worry because human ingenuity through mm-hmm. the forces of the market will always, you know, will come up with new solutions that will replace the resources that we were afraid about in the first place. Mm-hmm. So, you know, if you think about things like geoengineering and other stuff that we're looking at today. So I was thinking about what do we do with that camp of people? Mm-hmm. And the other thing that came up when the economist was speaking was, like, I work specifically with waste. So I think a lot about value and how we culturally assign value to things, to resources, to natural capital, to each other and our mm-hmm. relationships, et cetera. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So we live in this culture, especially in the US, where we don't really associate the material resources that keep us afloat with value. Mm-hmm. And I remember, you know, to the incentive piece, I remember talking to someone 10 years ago who's from Michigan and said, I grew up with a bottle deposit mm-hmm. and the bottle feels valuable because culturally that was mm-hmm. that was cultivated. So sometimes I wonder if, like, are we ready as a species to move to the point where compassion is enough to motivate people mm-hmm. to feel like they have to own a part of this as opposed to pushing things through economic incentives. So I guess the theme of my question is, to what extent does the market and kind of, you know, economic behavior play into how we move people to mm-hmm. fix this together?
Yeah, well, I would say absolutely that's part of the context. So there isn't any one, you know, what I'm really interested in is having this sort of an integrated view, so that so it's not denying that the market doesn't play a powerful and profound role, but just to not become overly fixated on that's all it's going to be and all it takes, because then that leaves out a whole other dimension, which is the kind of human, you know, subjectivity and creativity and all of that. So that's why I'm interested in that integral model, because I feel like there's a reason why we have that kind of, you know, the reason why some of these things really work with incentives and with behavior change, behavioral economics, it actually does work, but it's just not the whole picture. There's the work of someone named Elizabeth Shove, who is a British scholar who's written really beautifully about what she calls social practice theory. And it's recognizing that what we do is largely in a social context, that it's not like we're all going around as individuals making these decisions, that we are functioning within these complex social practices that include market and policy and, you know, just a number of profound contexts that influence this. But the point around the techno-utopian, I mean, I live in the Bay Area, right? And so that's really huge, especially in the South Bay, is that technology is going to solve it. And, you know, I'm not really sure what we need to do to respond to that. I think that's if some people feel that way, that's okay, right? I mean, but my way of reading that is predictably through the lens of defenses. You know, I really feel like when we get kind of fixated in that way, that it's a strategy of managing enormous anxiety. And what brings up a lot of anxiety is vulnerability and uncertainty and ambiguity and paradox and all of that. That can arouse and evoke enormous anxiety, and I don't mean on a conscious level. And so that's sort of my way of looking at that when I come across that is, you know, this sort of adherence to a technological fix. And so, you know, I don't really know quite what I would do about that, but just to maybe understand it and look at it through that lens might be helpful. You know, and again, I'd be really interested in what other folks might feel or think about that in the room. Especially those who have more of a psychological orientation, you know. But that's my take on it. So, yeah, thank you.
Hey. Hi. Thanks for bringing this conversation here, and thanks to Sustainable Path and Town Hall. Just briefly, while it's on the top of my mind, the concept of geoengineering or other challenging topics that not all of us might agree with or might have concerns with. For me, I've been challenging myself to eliminate the otherness in that and approach people with my concerns or with listening and witnessing and questions. Just got back from a 3-week pilgrimage to the tar sands and did a lot of listening to people that work in the oil industry, and did not get into any bar fights, and I didn't get beat up. So my question for you, Renee, is how and whether different genders respond to this material differently. Mm. Just kind of curious if there's anything in that you'd like to share with us, because I find that that would be just a question that I'd be curious about.
What do you think?
I guess my experience is that men often do head to the technology or the science, mm-hmm. and that women are more willing or able to mm-hmm. touch in on the feelings.
Right.
Not all men and not all women.
Yeah.
So, but it's I'm just curious what your experiences are in speaking with people.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's a tricky topic. I guess I would say that my observations... So at the Resilience Conference today, which was actually, would you say, largely male? Yeah. Someone in we had a small group discussion about how we relate with resilience in our own lives. And there was a man in the group who basically described a situation where he was stranded. It might have been, I can't remember what the context was, but it was like something, a big event had happened. It might have been 9/11, it might have been a natural kind of disaster, but he was stranded in a city and he couldn't get out. And he said it took him 2 days to figure out how to contribute to the issue that was happening. I can't remember what it was, but it was like he had 2 days where he said he was trying to figure out how to actually contribute. He said those 2 days were intolerable. And what I felt in what he was saying is how intolerable it can be for men. And I think this is it's cultural, it's social, it's, you know, all this stuff. I'm not being essentialist here by saying men are this and women are this. But this tendency to feel like a deep need to be effective and have impact, and how absolutely excruciating it can be to not be able to do something about what you're presenting, right? And so my experience is that there's a high proportion of people who are drawn and work in the sustainability sectors who are very much focused on doing and solving and fixing and don't have a lot of patience or threshold for looking at process and this kind of idea of what people might be feeling. I think it can feel like you're taking us down this rabbit hole. And we have to stay focused on the tactical and on the doing. And my experience of that is that it is very much related to anxiety, again, about what it's like to feel helpless and what it's like to feel powerless. So that's a tricky one. And I'm not saying we don't need to be doing all those things. But I do find that... I haven't really thought about it a whole lot, but maybe there's more women who seem to kind of resonate or get it a bit more, but it hasn't been obvious to me in that way. I guess I'm thinking more kind of culturally that we tend to see that kind of playing out, and that a lot in the kind of climate and sustainability sectors, especially when they're dominated by technology and engineering and science and policy, that there's kind of, it's a little harder. So I hope that helps. Thanks.
Hold on 1 second. And just, these will be our last three questions. That's all we have time for.
Thanks.
Hello, and thank you for that excellent talk. When, on the subject of the anxieties over what appear to be intractable problems and also the ambivalence about them, When discussing climate change and what it means and what potential solutions are, do you think it's helpful to discuss it, to discuss greenhouse gases in the context or the same context as CFCs and acid rain, which had not immediate but very noticeable impacts, and which the impacts were noticeable and the solutions were straightforward enough that something was done in both cases.
Mm-hmm. What's your instinct about that?
If we start with, we had problem A, we did solution A. We had problem B, we did solution A, or B. And then problem C is much more long-term and complicated, but a similar framework may work.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, I think it's really interesting. I think this is all terrain we're figuring out, which is around how we relate with the need for solutions and to know that there are solutions and to be sort of assured that it's possible that we can actually have some sort of impact. There's a lot of evidence that we respond favorably to that, but the challenge with climate change is it doesn't fit the problem solution framework. And so the risk is that if we frame it as a problem solution, that we potentially really disempower and alienate people, because it's sort of like, you know, we're looking for a solution, but we're actually dealing with more of a long-term situation, right, than a problem solution. Does that make sense? It's like, it's not that there aren't solutions, but that we're not talking about a kind of conventional problem solution framework. We're talking about a wicked problem, and it's what I've heard is now a super wicked problem. And so that suggests that it's like, so I'm really interested in playing and exploring, supporting our human capacity to be with and engage with super wicked problems. And what are those capacities? What are those capacities in terms of supporting our ability to tolerate uncertainty, to tolerate this kind of ambiguity, and still stay connected with, and hear stories of when we actually were able to solve this or resolve this issue. So it's sort of like holding that. That's something that I'm really interested in. So I could see how it would be powerful to invoke the greenhouse and the CFCs without becoming overly fixated on that, right? Does that make sense?
It does, thank you.
Okay, thanks. Hey.
Hey. So I want to add my thanks to others for really illuminating framing for all of this, and I especially want to comment that the four elements that you put up on the screen, I liked how when they came together, they looked like a 45 RPM record, which makes it just about my speed. So that said, I have two questions that are related. Mm-hmm. You mentioned George Lakoff earlier on, mm-hmm. and a group of us brought him here in 2004, mm-hmm. actually. And so within your framework of understanding, mm-hmm. Do you think that there are different groups who have different sort of ways of comprehending things, mm-hmm. in the way that he sort of framed it, such that there is a preferred way to engage? And then related is, I work in a corporate setting, mm-hmm. Negotiating with companies about improving their practices. And someone once said, it might have been Mark Twain, that you can't convince a man whose paycheck depends upon their believing, mm-hmm. otherwise.
That's absolutely right, yeah.
Yeah. So is there a particular application in a corporate setting of your framing? Mm.
Well, I think that's really important, and absolutely, that we seem to have these preferences, mm-hmm. and these modes of where we resonate and how our minds work. Mm-hmm. So it's not about trying to make us all become kind of one or the other, mm-hmm. but it's precisely about understanding through listening, through paying attention, through tuning in. Because, mm-hmm. really, what I'm interested in is attunement. Mm. And so how can we more effectively attune with our audiences and our stakeholders? And that includes our ability to understand, which I know that you have to do as your work. You have to be attuned. Mm-hmm. You have to listen. Mm-hmm. So that's why I'm very interested in the whole idea of building capacities sort of across sectors and across stakeholders, recognizing there is no one way. Mm-hmm. So how you take what I'm talking about and translate that into your particular context is going to be different and unique for what you're doing. Mm-hmm. And that's where I feel like there's the opportunity for real innovation, mm-hmm. that in a way we're all kind of innovators in this sense. Mm-hmm. So that's one thought there. Did you have another question?
Or was no, that those are the two.
Oh, the Lakoff.
The Lakoff, the different modes.
Yeah. So yes, there. Yeah, I would agree with that.
I think you use the word preference. People have different preferences.
Yes. Yeah, preferences, orientations, mm-hmm. Proclivities.
And so if a person has one proclivity or preference, mm-hmm. is there mm-hmm. a more adept way of kind of entering into the conversation? Mm. You know, when you're listening for the three A's, mm-hmm. Kind of focusing on one versus another, mm-hmm. in an order, does that resonate in any particular way, predictably? Or is it just sort of as the conversation unfolds?
Yeah, I'm not sure. I'm not sure about that. I guess what I'm interested in is working with the quadrant as a way in, but it's sort of like a doorway. Mm-hmm. And then I'm really interested in what happens when we are in that doorway. Mm-hmm. And so, for example, so I'm I work I've been doing a bit more kind of the corporate kind of, you know, engagement work. Mm-hmm. And so there's a lot of resonance, for example, with certain parts of the quadrant. But what I'm interested in is inviting, like, consideration of some of the other insights in the quadrants, mm-hmm. right? So it's sort of like you go in, but I really am interested in, okay, you know, how might some of the insight or perspectives from more of an emotional orientation, how might that mm-hmm. support or inform what we're doing? Mm-hmm. So, you know, that's, I feel like we have to kind of be training ourselves and pushing towards ever more an integrative, kind mm-hmm. of a systemic way of looking at these things mm-hmm. and not get overly fixated. And that's my concern, is that we do, because we're anxious, we get really fixated and obsessed. I mean, maybe some of you know, like, people who've read, like, the latest book on behavior, and it's like that becomes kind of the Bible. Social marketing is the Bible, or carbon conversations. And so I'm just concerned with that tendency to get too fixated.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, thank you.
That makes sense.
What you just said about it being a way in helps me, instead of it being a map of the entire journey. It's sort of
yes.
a way into starting the journey so that
yes.
you can take it together.
Exactly.
Thank you.
Right. Yeah, thanks. Hi.
Hi. Thank you so much. I'm probably going to say something that is one of those number one things you're not supposed to talk about is politics,
uh-huh.
Uh-huh, you know, in a social setting. But I'm going to get there in a minute, like after just a short story. I had to clean out my father's home in 2009 in Alabama. And I carefully took all the basement things and segregated out, you know, the toxic stuff, all the paints, the paint thinners, and the glass. And I went to the landfill, and I drove up and asked the guy, and I said, so where do I put the toxic stuff? And he said, over there in that big green dumpster. And I said, okay, where do I put the cardboard in that green dumpster? Where so everything mm. went in that green dumpster. Mm. And when I went up to it, I mean, it just, I wanted to cry. I mean, there are Christmas trees in there. Mm. Everything is in that green dumpster. Mm. So it really led me to think about why, because in 1981, I moved to Seattle, and we were already recycling. You put your newspaper and your plastics and glass. At that time, it was just newspaper and glass. But I thought, how can it be so divergent in two different parts of the country? And then I start thinking also about, it seems that there are political lines drawn between those who don't want to penalize companies to make them change their emissions or fix their cars, or, you know, and yet, why is it that it's the Democratic Party, and I could be wrong here, that seems to care more about mm-hmm. environmental issues and willing to penalize economically companies to get them to reduce their carbon emission? Mm-hmm. Or is it geographic? Because, like, the Southeast, you know, that's a whole mentality, and I don't think mm-hmm. this guy has any anxiety about the climate. I don't think he knows about it.
Mm-hmm.
So is it education? Mm-hmm. Is it poverty?
Mm-hmm.
Is it all of those things? And why does it divide down political lines,
mm.
in your opinion?
Mm. Well, So I guess how I'd respond, I can't offer an analysis of how people kind of align with particular political affiliations as ways of expressing our kind of way of being in the world and how that relates to geography, and it's just too complicated.
Yeah, it is.
But I will say that, you know, there's been sort of a trend in the past year or two, especially the past 2 years, of research that's coming out that you've probably seen or heard about that has to do with identifying, oh, Republicans tend to be like this and Democrats tend to be like this. And there's, you know, the book, The Political Brain, right, by Drew Weston. And there's quite a number of people coming out, Dan Kahan, who are doing analysis precisely looking at this through the political affiliation lens. And I really have a hard time with that, because I feel that if we look at this and kind of think about it almost like decoding, it's really about, again, how we're managing and expressing certain kinds of anxieties. So So I had the experience not long ago where I was contacted by someone who's a senior advisor for the Republican GOP. And he was funded by a private donor to do interviews and basically design messaging on climate for the Republican Congress. And so he got in touch with me, and we worked together and designed these ways of doing interviews and focus groups with 30 Republicans from around the country and then plus several focus groups. And the way we designed the interviews was using this kind of methodology where it's very conversational. Like, I completely rewrote the discussion guide. That's what is used to do interviews, where usually your people are being kind of fired at these questions. So we redid it so that they were very kind of coming at things from the side. What do you care about? What matters to you? So I did some of these interviews, and one of the people I interviewed was a woman in Nebraska, very right, climate skeptic, who also is very involved with, you know, sustainability in a way, you know, like gardening and organic, and I think she might have driven a Prius, you know, but yet didn't, you know, but had these very kind of Republican views, orientations. And so what I was really struck by in the conversation that I had was getting in touch with what really mattered to her, which had to do with integrity. And so her critique of, you know, Al Gore and climate was, you know, about walking the talk, and, you know, she was really fixated on this issue of integrity and hard work and what it means to work hard, you know, just had a lot of value. And so what I started to get a sense of was that this is sort of like what is underlying these things are anxieties about loss, about what can be lost, what's at stake and what's at risk. And so if we think about political affiliation as sort of these crystallizations, like there's all these systems out, like the Enneagram and personality, you know, they're like these crystallizations that help us make sense of the world. And I kind of see it in that way. And that they are kind of these crystallizations of strategies of managing. Now, how or why Democrats are more kind of tuned in to service, and I mean, it's just, it is complicated, you know, but I try to see it more as through in that way of trying to appreciate that, you know, we're trying to meet our needs as best we can, and it kind of becomes organized in these certain ways. So I don't know if that was helpful at all, but that's just my kind of hit on that.
It was. Thank you. I just want to say one other thing is my daughter did work for AmeriCorps, and she was on loan to the Seattle Parks Department for a year, and the goal there, which I thought kind of comes back to my question, is taking the inner city kids whose parents are poor, you know, they can never get out to go to the forest or go snowshoeing. They don't know what the environment is because they haven't gotten out of the city to go see it. So, you know, they would drive 12 kids out into the wilderness and let mm-hmm. them snowshoe and pitch tents. And mm-hmm. and so the idea is if they see the wilderness, maybe they won't, when they grow up, pour their car oil down, you know, the gutter, which, because maybe some people just aren't aware.
Right.
And we need to reach out to some of those pockets. And that's why I was wondering about education and poverty and how much that might play a role.
Right. Yeah, I wouldn't say everyone's walking around, obviously, like, anxious. Because awareness does play a role.
Yes.
I think I'm being a little like devil's advocate because we tend to focus almost exclusively on raising awareness in the environmental sectors. And we kind of leave out the fact that it's not just enough to raise awareness. We need to take into account what happens once awareness is raised, just how we process this information and what do we do with it, and thinking about how we can support people more effectively to then integrate, you know, what awareness, what it brings up for us, ideally in a supportive context. So, yeah, thanks.
Thank you all for coming.
Thank you.